So as I was saying, there's enough material here from a topic standpoint to from a topical standpoint, there's enough here for about a month or two in terms of lecture. Some of the topics that I will mention to you without going into definitions can require a day or two. And I mentioned to a couple of people already that I would be glad to hold seminars on individual things that are important, more relevant from a technical standpoint, understanding everything that's going on within them. We can have an ongoing series, and I can bring in other people who are attorneys and accountants that relate to those areas as well. So tell David if you're interested in something like that. I don't know everybody, so I'll just tell you my name is Marty Schmidt. We moved out here in the rainy land, my wife. We moved out here about 5 months ago. Lived in West Hempstead for about 42 years. And down here, nobody knows what West Hempstead is. with that in mind, I'll just tell you my background is in securities and insurance. I don't call myself a securities broker. I don't call myself an insurance agent. I get more involved in the planning aspect. Most of my business has come from tax attorneys and CPAs. The reason for that is because the concept of financial planning has become something very unusual in the state of Florida. Until 2 years ago, the number one profession in the state of Florida was what?
Real estate.
Thank you. Real estate. Number one. Today it's been surpassed. It's been supplanted by the words financial planner. Unfortunately, because of changes in the industry, both in the securities industry and the insurance industry, everybody went out and got themselves a license and calls themselves financial planners. That is detrimental to the people that really take it seriously and really know what's going on from an educational standpoint. On the other hand, it does make a point. The point is that this particular state is growing in leaps and bounds, and people like me, who are, I am 66, who are retiring, going to retire, are coming down here in droves. So the concepts vary. The discussion to a group between 40 and 65 years of age is very different. So the assumption I had to make because of the time of the day and because of the nature of the community was that it's basically a retiree population. Excuse me. Okay. And so from that standpoint, gearing the conversation, there are certain things that we're going to come to a peak with. And I'll gear that conversation to those areas. There'll be a lot of stuff covered. A lot of stuff will not be discussed in detail because there's just too much. So let me just begin a little bit. I won't use this too much. There's something on the back. At the end of this, I will give you three or four things which I think are pertinent to either yourself or your children or grandchildren. And that is a giveaway or a go-away event. So, in terms of financial planning, there's a gentleman by the name of Castigliano. I've read his books and I learned the processes that he used in terms of financial planning about 3 years ago. And he delves into the concept of financial planning in a slightly different way, which actually relates to us as a firm community. Because if you learn Gemara at all, you learn that there are 16 different ways to look at the same problem. In fact, you have very heady authorities giving you exact opposite opinions. Basically, what you're looking at is a sugya, an Indian, or some kind of source that you're looking at from a lot of different angles. A lot of different angles. If I put a tree over here, an apple tree, you can see the front when you're sitting over there, and you can see the apples are either good, bad, or different. Okay? You haven't gone inside, you haven't gone in the back. The three-dimensional aspect is there. If I tell you to take a photograph of this on the table, you'll go around and look around and look at the lighting, the color, the angle, what's behind it. But if I hang it from a corner over here, okay, you can see a 360-degree globe. You can view it from many different ways. That's what should be done. And in the recent 5 to 10 years, a lot of that is being done in a lot of different ways. So his theories have been in practice quite often. There are about 2,000 or 3,000 people in the country that use them, and so do I. You can get his books, that's another story, that's up to you. I don't really recommend anything in that respect. I don't want to be a chauffeur anyway. There's one common denominator. I handed out this three-page report. One common denominator everybody has, okay? And it's essentially, know yourself. I don't care what your work is. I don't care what your net worth is. It really doesn't matter. If you're a very wealthy person, you're worth $4, $5, $10, $20, $30 million, your problems are going to be different than everybody else that's worth under $1 million or $2 million. There's nothing here that's geared to any specific framework in respect to wealth, okay? But the problems will be different. In a retiree scenario, there's a lot less that has to be discussed because the nature of the product is geared not necessarily to a retiree. A person who is under 40 or over 45, 50, 55 is in a growth stage. Their risk aversion is very different than people who retire. They don't want to take as many chances in a retirement. Well, I shouldn't say that. I've seen too many things where retirees take too many chances. But the reality is that most people don't want to do that. So the common denominator is know yourself. Quick story about that. Quick story. New York Telephone Company, anybody remember that company?
Yes.
Okay. Long time ago, they asked me to speak to managers ranging in this is about 20 years ago, ranging in salaries from $35,000 to about $100,000 a year. And there were 2,000 people in the audience, which I know is not the greatest thing in the world for me because nobody's really listening, or if they are, and at the end of that, they asked the three of us, there were four of us speaking, to go out and speak to these group people in groups of 75 to 150. 15 nights, which I did. So the first night, I'm up at a board like this, a long board on the wall, and after going through introductions and everything, there were 85 people in the room, all managers. Managers, most of them married, some not. And I'm over here like this, and I said, okay, everybody in the room, just shout out, what are the 9 choices you have in your pension plan? And I'm like this, and I'm tripping over my tongue over here because I don't hear anything coming out. A pension plan to managers is one of the two largest assets they have. It's their pension and their home. Now, one person can come up with a single particular investment that they put into their pension plan for the last 10, 15, 20 years. Meaning they had no idea what they were invested in for the long term. Kind of weird. So I took my car, my 3x5 index card, ripped it up, and I said, this is what you're going to do. If you look at those sheets in front of you, there's a list of expenses. And the next night, I said, fill this out tonight. The next night, come and see me. I'll be in the next room speaking to a different group and tell me what you find out. What is it? If you list all your expenses, and I'm not telling you that you have to do this. Some of you think you know it. Some of you do know it. But if you list all your expenses, and you take a look at that against, and you're honest by the way, and you look at that against your net income, people will come out, they're spending more than they make more than they spend, or it's somewhere around flat. And that leaves you with the decision process. But you cannot, and this, I think the seminar was the title of Maximization, you cannot optimize and maximize anything unless you know what the base is. You have to know what your foundation is. If you don't know what's here, anything you do is just pure guesswork. And that is what most people I see, and most people my colleagues see, tend not to do. Not understand what the original foundation is, and they tend to spread a lot of bad news. And each time I tell somebody to do this, they come back to me, wow, I'm spending $125,000 a year, my net income is $80,000. Not a retiree scenario necessarily, but different. What do you do about that? That's what a financial planner's job is supposed to do, to ask a lot of questions and find out what the real story is. So you've got to do that. My suggestion is, if you're not really up to this, do it anyway. It takes 15 minutes to 20 minutes. Two people can work on it together. It doesn't make a difference. Estimate. When you come up with your total expenses, jack it up by 10 to 20%. Something always happens, whether it's medical, a new car, refrigerator dies, hot water heater, whatever the story is. Grandchild is born. Expenses come up. So that's the kind of thing you have to develop. Everything else after that I'm going to talk about afterwards is based on the fact that you have a foundation established, that you know where you are. Otherwise, you cannot maximize, you can't optimize anything. One more thing about optimization. You've got to keep this in mind, too. There's no perfect solution. L-shaped curve, right? Standard statistical stuff. I'm not going to get technical. It's broken down into segments, 67%, 92%, and there's a little bit left over here. No matter what you go to, this is how it's broken down. People who want to optimize something, they'll look to have, get this last piece down here, maybe 2%, 3%, 5% of what's left over, to optimize any scenario, I don't care what it is. It usually is not worth the time, effort, or money to go after that last piece. Oh, I'm getting a rate of return of 4.5% on my municipal bonds, I really want 4.75. It's usually too expensive to do that, and probably takes a longer time to do that. And that's just a simple example. So optimization takes into account you personally. Everything is case sensitive. What Bernie does is not necessarily what you're going to. I don't know your first name, I'm sorry.
Larry.
What he wants to see is not the same as what Bernie does, and vice versa. I was telling Stu beforehand that if somebody has a stock tip for you, it may not be the best thing in the world for you to do. How do you know it's a good stock in the first place? You have to do your homework. That's another foundational thing. So the common denominator is very important. Now, what we do, myself and my colleagues, we tend to ask people to give me their tax returns, 3 years of tax returns, at the very least two. I want to see a copy of all the portfolios, any form of securities, I don't care what they are, and I want to see any insurance policies, I don't care what kind of insurance policies they are. Right? And that's where the thrill on my end comes in and the shock. Another example, Harvard graduate, South Florida, surgeon, asked a colleague of mine to have us meet him. I should say him. I'm not going to give any names away. Still in practice. Ended up in a second divorce. Couldn't practice anymore as a surgeon, had back surgery himself. Started a new practice, do cosmetic stuff, whatever. And we asked him to sit down and talk with us. I asked him to bring all that stuff with him. Okay? He brought a bunch of envelopes and folders, and he handed me his statements for his securities portfolio. Three envelopes, year end, 3 years back. None of these envelopes was open. Inside they were this thick. 84 pages of securities on a $3.5 million series of portfolios. What had happened to this guy? I don't wish on a dog. He was worth $25 million. Second divorce, she took him for $17 million. Okay, $7 million net worth assets, of which $4 million was his home. Man had expense habits beyond belief. He was paying $200,000 to $250,000 a year for gardening expenses. He had no idea that he was going to run out of money in 7, 8, 9 years, somewhere in that range. He was going to run out of assets. Okay, and that's what typically financial planners are looking for today. Are you going to outlive your assets? That's a big question. Okay, it's a big question. What we did with him was very different. He had purchased some really bad stuff. He had annuities on the books, which were with a company that was not top of the line. They were underperforming. He didn't know it. His assistant was paying all his checks for everything he does. And she was adding money to these portfolios for 4 years that he didn't know was underperforming. He was losing his money like crazy. All right? He hadn't looked at anything. And it's critical. What we did is we eventually consolidated that with one of the largest insurance companies in the world. It's actually a British company. That has affiliates all over the United States as well. And we converted his six annuities that we bought that were underperforming into one with a very high quality scenario, increased his assets technically, okay, can change a little bit, to by $1.9 million over 12 years. It took him from running out of assets at age 78, he was 63 and a half at the time, to 95. Now, if he just takes a hold of his expenses at that point in time and gets a hold of them, like the garden or anything else, he's not going to outlive his assets, even though he's down 70% of what he was in the past and couldn't even work at the level he wanted to work.
What about selling a $5 million home?
$4 million home. What about it?
Why not downsize?
Oh, there are a lot of solutions. You're absolutely correct. That's a very good point. Sometimes they're radical. You have to deal with the individual and his family. He was remarried a third time. And the concept of selling a home and moving and downsizing is easy to say when you're in a house that you built and put together and so on and so forth. You're dealing with personalities.
She'll get it in the end, don't worry about it.
No comment. Okay, two major areas of concern. How about guess what the major areas for retirees are? I've got two. What's important to you? That's number two. Or number one. Mm-hmm. Right, what's the other one?
Mm-hmm.
There you go. Both of them. Easy, right? Mm-hmm. Try a room with 45-year-old. All right, income and health. So let's address both of these in different fashions. Some of this is repetitive to you, some not, but if you put it in sequence, it will make some sense. And that's what I'm trying to do here. Okay, in both of these areas, there are two subheadings that are important to both of these and to everybody in the room, in fact, everybody that lives in this or any other country. What economic factors is something that we deal with every day? If it's for me, I'm not here.
What was the question?
What economic feature do we deal with every single day, every year?
Inflation.
Yes. That's not an economic factor.
Taxes.
Okay. What I'm talking about is borrowing. Well, let's go a different route. Okay. All right, let's use it. Right? Inflation? Right? Does everybody know what, if you don't know what inflation is, don't be embarrassed, raise your hand. If you know what it is, fine. Okay. So we're dealing with this every day. Anything you do financially is going to have to deal with this. As at a retiree level, if you think this is going away for you in the next 5, 10, 15, 20, God willing, 30 or 40 years, you're sadly mistaken. You have to plan for this. That's why people who are retired can't just sit back and relax. There are people who are getting $200,000, $300,000, $400,000 a year in income and spending $50,000 a year and don't want to spend any money anymore. That is great and it's wonderful. But no matter what you do, you're affected by this. It's the buying power of the dollar and it's not going to stop going up. There are too many economic factors that revolve around this world. What's the other factor that's related to retirees as well as non-retirees? Longevity. Everybody in this room is testimony to that. My father turned 93 3 weeks ago. My father-in-law is 91. People are living to 100 or more. It's a regular event. Many of you people know these people, okay? Longevity is critical. That's why you can't sit back on your heels at 70, 75, and 80. It's a constant review process. No matter how much I tell somebody like this, I think it goes in one ear and out the other when they're at that age bracket. I don't know why, but it's very, very important to deal with all the areas. Under healthcare, okay, we're dealing with, again, on the retiree level. Does everybody know what a healthcare proxy is? Does anyone not know what a healthcare proxy is? Does everyone have one? Who doesn't have one? Get it, okay. Very important. Long-term care insurance. Typical question I get from everybody. Let me tell you what the status is for retiring as opposed to asking questions. Long-term care insurance over 65, 70 years of age is extraordinarily expensive. Very, very difficult. If you're under 250,000 liquid assets, as a rule of thumb, it's going to be out of your realm. Unless you go into the policy and take a lesser benefit level. So instead of paying you $300, $400, $500 every time a situation comes up, it's $150 a day. It certainly helps a little bit. The statistical level is such that whatever you pay in premiums for a long-term care policy, the average statistic, not for everybody, the average statistic is you're going to get it back in terms of payments because you're going to run into these kinds of problems as you age. You should never have to run into the problem to lose the money for the coverage. If you're in the 60-65 bracket already, just to let you know, it's higher above that. But if you want a Cadillac product in the industry and you want every bell and whistle, it's going to cost you $12,000 to $15,000 a year per individual. You can get that down to $5,000 to $6,000 by reducing the benefits. But long-term care insurance is something, if you don't have it right now, is worth investigating. A lot of it has to do with your current health scenario, and you certainly can pass that on to a lot of other people who you might know who might want to look into it as well. There are a lot of bells and whistles that have changed. A lot of companies have gone out of the business. And the ones that are still in the business have reduced the bells and whistles and increased the premiums in the last 3 years alone by as much as 50%, maybe more. The reason? Because they took on so many people with so many lower premiums when they first introduced the product. It's not an old product, a couple dozen years old. Okay? And they've got so many people on the books with the longevity factor, they have to pay out so much more over time, they knew that the reserves they had to keep with the state insurance departments was not going to be there to cover many more people with those kind of benefits. That's where an actuary does. He figures out all these tables to determine. So they had to either eliminate the product from the sales picture, or bump up the premium if you want to buy it and pay for it, or eliminate the product completely, I should say. Disability coverage. It's a moot point with this group because usually it goes up to 65 years of age. Medicare, you probably know more about it than I do. However, Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, they have certain features associated with health care which you have to check into. Hand these out. This is a BlackRock, you know the name, if you don't know the name, it's unimportant, I'm not a show for them. It's a brochure they put out, and there's one thing in here that that I will point to later in terms of taxation, okay? And that will be important there. But it's something, again, most of the stuff in there you will know. It's interesting reading for the bathroom, more than likely. Supplemental plans, existing corporate benefit plans, if you work for a corporation, you have a health care plan that still exists. If, by the way, if you were in the military, and you are not collecting benefits, it pays to call up the Veterans Administration and see if you were entitled to it. Because if you were and you didn't collect, you'd be interested in the bonus you could collect. I found this, when I mentioned this one time, one guy called me up and said he was entitled to it. He got back something like $180,000. I think it's unusual. Most people knew what their benefits were when they got out of the military, and I don't know if anybody here was in the military, but that's the case. Okay, so let's go to the income category over here. It's very important to everybody in this room. It's very important to everybody, period. And what we're dealing with are, right here. What we're dealing with is products. And we're dealing with, I don't like to put it in any order, protection. I'm sorry? You have a question? Okay. And tax efficiency. Now, because of legal circumstances, Bernie and Esther can. I cannot give you tax advice. I have restrictions. I cannot give you legal advice. There are things that crop up when you're doing a plan for somebody, you're working with somebody on plans, that I can suggest from a tax angle. I can talk to you about specific products and what their tax angles are. But because of the generic nature of, you know, of recommending things from a tax angle or recommending taxable suggestions, I'm restricted. However, I will answer questions to the best that I can, and I'll try and guide you along the line based on product or anything else. So if we deal with products as an example, by the way, if I say anything that's questionable, you don't remember it, you don't understand it, please stop me. Very important. Okay, under products, part of this, what I'm about to tell you right now, is going to be critical with reference to this feature, protection. And I asked the question of Stu before, I asked him and he said, you're kidding me. And I said, no, I'm not kidding you. So when you're dealing with products, you're dealing with stocks, bonds, and cash. That's the primary emphasis. Stocks, bonds, and cash. Everything else would be considered or come under the heading of something called alternative investments. Some of them are very common, like real estate. Some of them are not so common to people who have never met it beforehand, like hedge funds. Okay? But alternative investments play a major role in the protection factor, and also understanding what you can do for yourself, assuming there was the capital to do so. I'm looking for one page here that I thought might be of interest to you. I don't see it. Okay. What are some of the investments that come under the aegis of something else other than stocks, bonds, and cash? Anybody?
Real estate.
I'm sorry? Real estate?
Commodities.
Gold.
Commodities.
Oil and gas.
Commodities, oil and gas, okay. Anything else?
Partnerships. Hmm? Partnerships. Oil and gas partnerships.
LPs? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Anything else? How about annuities? Is that an investment?
Generally not.
What was that?
I don't think so.
No? Anybody else? Okay, annuities, just as a sidebar real quickly, there are two types of annuities, fixed and variable. Fixed does not allow you a choice of investment structures. It comes under the aegis of the insurance companies and their regulations. Variable annuities, you're going to choose investments, mutual funds usually. It comes under the direction aegis of the SEC, FINRA. It is considered a securities instrument because it's comprised of securities and has the risk internally of securities. So there are certain things that can come up, and I have these kind of questions for you. They're worth understanding.
Insurance is also an investment.
Sorry?
Insurance in general.
Yes, it can be. Did everybody hear that? Insurance is also considered an investment.
Have the reverse mortgage.
Is that an investment or is that an income product?
Well, it's an income product.
What do you lose?
Well, supposedly I don't.
Huh?
Supposedly you don't. Theory you don't.
The people who go into reverse mortgages are usually in a situation that are required rather than they're liking it as an investment, right? The risk factor is pretty well defined. And that is something that also goes hand in hand with investment structures. I probably wouldn't put it under an investment category, an income category. As an income level, it is an option if you're in dire straits, which is typically what this was developed for in the first place. It's a bell and whistle that somebody else is going to win in the process. If it fits you, if it fits your own circumstances, again, everything is case sensitive, then it's something to look into. It's a big deal today. People lost a lot of money in housing over the last 5, 6, 7 years, since 2008 actually. So I'm gonna ask you a silly question, but I do wanna tell you that the concept of asset allocation when it comes to products is critical. It can't be any more critical to your well-being in finances. Because it has to be malleable, you have to be able to make changes from time to time, and those changes will be geared specifically to the markets you're invested in, and trying to take advantage of it or optimize the best situation at that point in time. You don't want to do this every week unless you're trading. Okay? You want to be able to do this every quarter, every half a year, every year. You want to look at the bigger picture. Asset allocation, how much you own in, you know, a pie chart, how much you have in stocks, how much you have in bonds, how much you have in real estate. That could be changed. If you have non-malleable, you can't change things like real estate. That's very hard to do it, all right? But people who have real estate as an investment, I don't know if anybody in the room does, I'll just mention this. There's a protection factor that you have. There's a real estate trust you can set up. Or you can set up a real estate program such that you borrow money against the real estate, okay, and put it into a product that particular state allows you to prevent you from being hit from a creditor standpoint. In other words, they can't tell you those assets. That's a form of protection also, but that's few and far between. I don't know how many people have real estate investments in this room. Now, this is where I'm going to go off the track a little bit, and I'm going to ask you a question. It's going to sound stupid, but it also leads, as I told somebody before, to something else that has a lot to do with something you can do to protect your portfolios if you have stocks and bonds. Okay? What is a stock? Anybody?
It's an interest in a company.
Do you own the company?
You own a portion of the company.
You own a proportion of the company. You own one share, you own a piece of that company. If it's 5 million shares, you own 5 million. Whatever it is, okay? It means ownership in the company. How does a stock come about? Does everybody understand what a stock is? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, good. It represents ownership. Does a bond represent ownership? Be quiet.
No.
Why not?
It's a long loan.
It's debt. It's called a debt instrument. So you have stock, which comes under the equity because you have equity in a company, and you have debt instruments. That make my job easier instead of explaining how a stock comes about, which just cut out a nice 5-10 minutes. With that in mind, understanding what a stock leads to gives me the following. I'm going to skip here. I'm going to use the term. I'll leave this up here. I'll leave the term derivative. I'm skipping here for a moment. There's a reason for that. If you understand what a stock is, where it comes from, what it's comprised of, how it's marketed, who handles the controls of it, who has control of the stocks, and what the international influence is, what the economic influences are on the stock, this is why I asked you the question. There's a lot that goes into what happens with the stock. It's easy to understand, I'll buy it to make a gain, or I'm going to get a dividend out of it. But the key is, How do you use the product for your benefit rather than just looking for a capital gain? Example, if you have a portfolio of stocks, and I can give you the arithmetic on this, maybe I'll do it later. If you have a portfolio of stocks and you have losses, you bought $100,000 worth of stocks and it went down pretty quickly to $90,000. You're going to sit there and cry on the sidelines and say, I just lost $10,000 on paper. There's something called harvesting losses. This is something you have to look into. If not, call me, I'll give you some information. Okay? Harvesting losses can actually prove to you, or I can prove to you, that you can actually make money. I'll give you an example, if you want, where if you invest $100,000, you lose, and you go back into the marketplace and so on and so forth by harvesting a loss, you get a tax benefit, which is an incremental tax benefit. Then in the end, that stock turns right around. Instead of getting, in my example, an 8% return, I got a 14% return. Just by harvesting a loss, taking the loss intentionally. I forgot the name of the individual who wrote a very technical book on this matter, but he proved that on average, by harvesting losses, you can increase your net yield by 0.75% or more. Yes?
Give us an example.
Sure.
I don't understand.
Yeah, sure, I will. Let me see if I have an example here.
Can I give you an example?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. A year and a half ago, everyone was very excited when Facebook came out. Facebook came out, and let's say you didn't get any through your broker, but you were so excited about Facebook, you threw an order in, and you got Facebook at $42, and you watched as Facebook kept dropping and dropping and dropping. And there are several ways you could consider harvesting the loss. You could sell your shares. You could anticipate that Facebook was not going to forever be down in the doldrums. And when it was $22, you could say, okay, I'm willing to step up and buy another 100 shares of Facebook. And then you can wait a minimum of 31 days and sell your original 100 shares of Facebook that you bought at 40 something. And you would be harvesting a loss on your first 100 shares of Facebook.
You haven't made any money.
Understand.
Sure. Okay. Let me give you a real example of numbers. I wrote this up. Imagine the first day of any given year. I sent this to somebody else. That's why it's written up this way. You invest $100,000 in the U.S. market. And what do you buy? You buy a SPIDER. Anybody know what a SPIDER? An ETF is an electronic traded fund. It's a form of mutual funds that trades every day at an exchange. It's a little bit more aggressive. Generally, they follow indices, different types of indices. But if you buy it for $100,000, you buy the S&P 500 index, the SPIDER is the call. And it trades off by 10%. It's worth $90,000. I'm going to show you that rather than, as I said, you're not going to feel sorry for yourself by doing this, but you sell the ETF and you reinvest the $90,000 back into the market. I don't want to get into the concept of the wash sale rules, which is 30 days. That's for another story. I'm just going to give you the numbers. So you're going to keep your market exposure constant by buying back into the marketplace. And for IRS purposes, for tax purposes, you just realize a taxable loss of $10,000. Okay? Now that you can use against any capital gains or any income or sources that comes up later on. But you've got an incremental tax savings in the form of a bigger refund. Okay. By keeping your market exposure constant, this is critical important factor. You really haven't changed your investment structure to cash flow, just a potential cash benefit. Now let's say the market reverses course, as Esther was saying before. It goes from 100 to 90, now it goes to 108,000. Buy and hold. I bought it at 100, it's now 108, I've got myself an 8% return. Less, whatever, okay? The initial investment was 100,000, you close that 108,000, gives you a 10% pre-tax return. When you're adding a typical, on the S&P, you're gonna get an average of 2% dividend yield. If you're in a marginal tax bracket, don't question about it, let's call it 50%, you'll net out with 1% on the 2% dividend. All right? The marginal benefit is important. If you did nothing but buy and hold, as I said, you got an 8% return. If you replaced your stock position, as I said, meaning you harvested the tax loss, and then you rebought back in, you have a loss of $10,000 and you can offset ordinary income. What is that? You can offset ordinary income or other taxable gains on your tax return. Right? So at the assumed marginal rate of 50%, I'm just running through this in my head, that would be worth $5,000 to $10,000, right? in income tax savings or another 5% return on the original 100,000. So now you've got your net return of 9% on the marginal plus the 5%, and you've got a 14% return by harvesting that loss instead of 8. Meaning that in a sad situation, you can actually use derivatives, which is like in the form, let's say, an option, to improve your position that's on the books as a loss to a break-even or even a capital gain. That gets very, very technical. It's not easy to do. You couldn't do it on your own, but it requires people to understand derivatives. Okay? So that's what, if, is that understandable? Yes?
You better be a little careful because you cannot, you can only take off $3,000 in 1 year to go.
Not if you match law against law. You're matching law, gains and losses.
I'm saying, you have ordinary income. You can only
yes, yes. The tax situation does vary by individual, absolutely. What he was talking about, I forget your first name.
Terry.
What Terry was talking about was the fact that you have a capital loss. As an individual rather than a corporation, you can carry forward losses forever. If you have $100,000 gains next year, and you had $100,000 of losses, you can offset the two, short versus short, long-term versus long-term, and then short versus long. On the other hand, a corporation can only use it for 5 years. You have the right to carry that tax loss forward forever, and you can only use $3,000 a year, unless the gains are larger, which can offset the total.
Be careful about that. Anybody from New Jersey will tell you that's not true.
I know. It's a state-by-state scenario, and as I said, this is a generic conversation that's worth looking into. There are a lot of technical stuff that we cannot get into. There's just not enough time. And they're also, from a tax aspect, there are a lot of aspects to this. The tax law codes are just extraordinarily difficult. They change constantly. In the last 2 years alone, accountants are going absolutely bonkers with what's been going on, especially with the high net worth clients.
One of the things, we're on the right track in terms of what you just said. The way of harvesting is also they're constantly selling options against those positions, reducing your cost basis by doing so, and that eventually, okay, if you're in the right vehicle, it turns around, and then you can make up on the other side.
Aaron is absolutely correct, except we're a little bit ahead of it because people don't necessarily understand what an option is, and that's what I was going to get into.
Well, you introduced it.
I know. That's why I said I was going to introduce it with the opposite protection. That's why I see a little ahead of it.
Right.
You're too smart. Okay. From a tax efficiency standpoint, what did I say up front? You got to know yourself. Does everybody know what their own tax bracket is?
I think the word in the United States is always too high.
I'm serious. If you know your tax bracket, raise your hand. One family. Five people out of how many people know? Six. If you don't know your tax bracket, and you do have money to invest, or you need some kind of insurance back, or whatever else it is, you're playing a guessing game again. Ask your accountant, what's my tax bracket? Has it been stable over the past 3, 4, 5 years? Has it changed a lot? If I do X, Y, and Z this year, is it going to change again? Again, from a financial planning standpoint, if you're going to make decisions from now forward, if you don't know the answer to that question, find it out. It's very important. Again, let's go back to the income scenario. Do you buy, if you don't know what your tax bracket is and you want to buy investment instruments, do you buy a tax-free instrument? Do you buy a taxable instrument? This is critical stuff. Why? You understand what bonds are? Okay. It's a debt. Bonds move in conjunction with what?
Interest
rates. Don't ever answer a question again, Aaron. I'm going to shoot you. Okay? Interest rates, right? Why? You don't have to know. Picture a jeweler's scale. Okay? Interest rates, price. Any debt instrument, whether it's a U.S. Treasury, a preferred stock, a corporate bond, I don't care what it is, a bond, it's very heavily related to interest rates. If rates go up, prices go down. If rates come down, prices go up. It's very simple. The arithmetic is not important right now, not for this meeting. It's simple arithmetic, by the way. But what happened up until this year? Interest rates came way down. And who suffered? Everybody, retirees especially. They were making 4, 5, 6, 7, 8% of their money. Now they're making 1, 2, 3, 4, 5% of their money. And 5 is high. All right? but it's relative to interest rates. If you don't know your tax bracket, do you buy a taxable instrument or a tax-free instrument? Example, municipal bond, 10 years out. Taxable bond, 10 years out. It's both same credit rating, A rating. Municipal bond gives you 3%, taxable bond, fictitious number just to make a point, gives you 7%. You're in a 15% tax bracket, you've got a 7% instrument, what are you making?
15% tax bracket?
If you're in a 15% tax bracket, and you have 7% return, you pay 15% in taxes, you're netting out what? Six and a fraction?
Seven.
Okay. Buy a municipal bond, 3% tax free. Aren't I better paying the taxes over here, collecting 6% in my pocket, rather than 3% because it's a tax free bond? Exaggerated example, but it's real. I can't tell you how many tax returns I take a look at, and I see two columns on the front page. Taxable, tax-free, tax-deferred, that kind of stuff. But I ask them, what are they doing in their portfolios? They're brokers in this room. They know this. They can ask the question of their clients, what's your tax bracket? We need to know. I can't give you the wrong investment advice. You have to know this stuff, okay? Okay, Aaron mentioned options. I'll skip ahead again. It's a derivative. An option is a product that's derived from an underlying security. Call it a stock. Okay? An option gives me the right to buy X amount of shares at a specific price by a certain point in time. It's complicated. It's not easy to think if you're not familiar with it. It gives me the option, the ability to buy a stock trading right now at $5 a share. I buy an option for a dollar. It's fictitious, but let's say it's a dollar. Okay? Gives me the right to buy 100 shares at 6.5. Okay? This option, just like a stock or a bond, trades in an options market. Markets are geared to making sure that buyers and sellers come together in an orderly fashion. When you buy a stock, you don't know who you're buying it from. It's coming through a market condition. Options trade in the market also. They're very aggressive as compared to the stock. So speculators, guys that like to take a chance, okay, short-term, intermediate-term, okay, there are options now that go out as long as 2 years, but for normal purposes, they typically are only 9 months long, all right? I have the option to buy XYZ stock for 100 shares for a price of $1 per share. If the stock goes from 5 to 6.5, somebody has to give me my stock because I'm going to buy it at 6.5. Okay? Someone's going to have to give me that stock. If I sell you the option to buy, if I own 100 shares of XYZ, and I sell you the right to buy my stock if it goes to 6.5, what do I end up with if you end up with my stock? I end up with $5 that I bought it for plus a gain of $1.50. Because you're taking the stock away from me at 6.5. But in the process, I also took from you the fee for that right to buy my stock. In other words, I'm playing a conservative game. I'm letting you take the risk if it works, because that option has a maturity level of 9 months. If you buy it 6 months into the picture or brand new, it's going to end up at zero, valueless. It's a very aggressive instrument. And it trades constantly, all day long, every day. The closer you get to the expiration date of 9 months, the more it's going to be volatile, and the lower that price is going to get. It's a dangerous game for people who don't understand it, but it's a conservative game for somebody who writes the option, gives somebody else the ability to play the game, either trade the option itself for the price or pick up the stock if it does go there. If it never goes to 6.5, and it expires, I've collected this, reduced my price, my base price, by $5 less a dollar. Now it's only cost me $4, my original stock. Is that protection? Damn straight. Okay. Is it an income? Oh yeah. May not be this price high, but there are different types of options to buy. If it doesn't go to 6.5 or more, and the option expires, I'll rewrite another one. taking another income, maybe it's 50 cents for another option. Reduce my average cost from 5 to 1 to 4 to 3.5. Maybe I'll write one for it to make this in stock still the same price. Take up to 6.5 again. It doesn't make a difference. You can, there are optimum choices there, which you need a professional to get to you. But that's what Aaron was leading to beforehand. That's what he was saying. It's a form of protection, another form of protection. You can protect an individual stock in your portfolio, or you can protect an entire portfolio. There are ways to do that too without going to every single stock. All right?
Mark, yes? I think you're making this sound like it's a risk-free income stream.
It's not risk-free.
Because you can't sell a stock in those 9 months. If it goes down to zero,
yes,
you're stuck to
what Terry's saying.
If it goes to 100, you haven't made it.
Time constraints notwithstanding, you have to check into this, they're not going to do it themselves.
It's not
but you can lift the lift, meaning you can get out of this. Okay, you can reverse the option position on your own books and take it off the books through the exchange.
No, I think that you can sell it unless it's a tax-free account, an IRA account. If you did an IRA account, then you can't sell the stock before you sell the call. Okay? But if it's a taxable account, you can sell the underlying stock in what you call being naked.
Well, being naked is a very, I'm really going into the
Let me stop all of you.
You don't own the stock and someone has a right to
Give
the stock to somebody. Your stock goes to 100, you've just...
Terry, you're arguing... Aaron, please.
I just want to make sure people don't think this is a risk.
I'll make the point, please. Okay. But you got to understand, you're going to get into a technical conversation where it's not what this venue is for.
I understand.
Okay? What we're dealing with here is taxation. We're dealing with the actual process of doing this, which requires you to contact a professional. It is not that difficult, and that professional's job, legally, is to inform you of what the risks and the rewards are. And doing this is a fairly conservative way of adding income, okay? And it's called, I should write it down, it's called the Covered Right Program. Covered rights. If you have a portfolio of stock, or you have individual stocks, okay? Check with your broker. Talk to them about it. Okay? It is a very, very significant way of protecting yourself. You don't have the total exposure to the stock at that point in time. Okay? And there are bells and whistles, as Terry pointed out. Okay? On the protection side, I'm going to rattle off a lot of stuff right here. By the way, on the potential products, from a tax efficiency standpoint, is municipal bonds. That means governments that are not the federal government, agencies of the government, things of that nature. There's a mutual agreement. I should mention what's been going on with that. There's a mutual agreement between the states and the federal government, such that the states have now issued New York City, New York State, Pensacola, whatever it is, they issue bonds, and the investor will not pay a federal tax if you buy within your own state or some other ancillary places like Puerto Rico or Long Harbor. But essentially, you're saving federal taxes by buying municipal bonds in your own state. That's what the agreement is. Every single year, the question comes up from the federal government, we don't want to start giving away, we want to tax them on the federal side too. It never works. Will it ever take away the federal tax relief status from that? I don't know. It's going to be a very, very hard thing to do. I'm not a government individual and I don't really care, but they've been trying to do this now for 20 years every single year and it happens. So you do have a federal taxation with that. The instruments from a taxation standpoint, IRAs, right? Does everybody have IRAs? Anybody have an IRA?
Yeah.
Have you spent it down?
Spent it down?
Have you taken, yeah.
Then, have you taken money out of it?
Yes.
Yeah,
that's 70.5, yeah. Yes. I forgot the name of the age of the, I apologize. I was going to go for a tax angle there again. Terry knows what I'm talking about. But the bottom line is, it's a tax-related instrument. IRAs, Roth IRAs, even in corporate situations, which is not pertinent here, there are actually 401k Roths, depending on the corporation. Is Social Security, does it have a tax benefit to it?
A tax benefit?
Yeah. Your brochure? Did you get that brochure? Turn to page 5. You probably know this.
You're paying the lawyer?
You probably know this. Bottom right hand corner. taxation of benefits and Social Security benefits. You're not going to pay tax on everything. So there is a tax benefit, if you want to call it that, by a form of reduction. So Social Security benefit does have a tax-free or tax-deferred element to it. Protection. How do you reduce volatility? You can get out of stocks completely if you want to, mutual funds also, right? You can diversify. What does that mean? If I diversify my stock portfolio and I buy Ford, Toyota, General Motors, is that diversified?
No.
Why not?
Same industry.
Means, in a generic way, that if the auto industry falls, everything falls, okay? It's all going to go in the same direction. So diversification requires that you're in different instruments, different categories of length of time, different risk-averse type of categories, which has to be determined by you yourself, okay? And it also helps you determine the asset allocation, which I talked about importantly, has to do with a constant evaluation. Don't give up on that fact, regardless of what your portfolio is. Always check in line of what the market's doing, what the tax returns have been, what the tax law changes have been that relate to you. Even Medicare, they change provisions every single year in Medicare. Yes, they do. And that may have an effect on you, and it's important to check that, evaluate it. Okay? Just as a sidebar, supplemental plans, and maybe it's a little too late here. Okay. So on the equity side, diversify by industry. Okay. You can diversify by classification in terms of risk. There's something called beta. Greek, but it's an easy explanation. When you look up a company, you can check what its beta is. It starts with neutral as one. So if the market moves in a direction, say it goes up 10%, you can expect that stock to do about the same. If it drops 10%, you can expect that stock to do about the same. The higher the beta, the more the turn. Meaning, the stock has 1.5 beta. If the market goes up 10%, you can expect that stock to do something along the lines of 15%, 1.5 times that, and vice versa. The higher the beta, the bigger the risk. Okay? So you can diversify by the risk factors associated with that. There are all sorts of fundamental and technical things you can check on, which I can't go into here, such as price earnings ratios, book ratios, asset ratios. There are tons of stuff which has nothing to do here right now. Understand that if you do invest along those lines, especially if you do your own investing, you really should learn more about this stuff. It's worthy of another seminar just to hear this kind of stuff, and it's worthy about reading it. You should get the books. Okay, since we're talking about that, on the bottom here, can everybody see this? Can you see this on the bottom? I'll draw it up here if you want me to. Okay, can everybody see that?
Yeah,
good. Okay, it's a bell-shaped curve. Fellow by the name of Stan Weinstein, Florida resident. I learned technical analysis by reading this guy's stuff for 5, 6, 7 years. He still writes stuff. He doesn't write the publishing paper called The Tape Reader. Okay? And what he said is coincidental to the definition of Einstein's theory of insanity. Anybody know the definition of insanity?
Same thing over and over.
I knew you would have the answer.
Expecting a different result.
What he said was, Einstein says, you do the same thing over and over and over again, expecting a different result. He defined it as insanity. Okay. What the retail broker, a retail investor does, has never stopped. They still do the same thing over and over again. Sam Weinstein tried to identify it on a graph. It's ideal here. Stocks typically don't move in this fashion. But charting itself is a way of protecting yourself a little bit more by putting the odds in your favor. Okay? And people who do this understand this. And there are some people that are really good at it, some people are really bad at it. It's actually reading pictures. Okay? You know what I'm talking about, right? Okay? So, but Stan said that the typical retail investor waits for a stock to come down, watches it start to go up, finally says, I'm going to jump on this bandwagon. If this stock is $10 down here, and somebody expects it to go to $20 up here, fictitious number, okay? The guy's watching his stock waffle all over the place, and he's looking for a buy, and somebody recommends a stock to him, he sees the stock here at $10, and it goes to 11, he's not sure whether to buy it or not, he's not sure if to pay, he doesn't know anything about the technicals and the fundamentals of the stock and buying and selling. And eventually Essentially, the typical retail investor will see the stock, and he says it's going to go to $20 a share. It's back around $14, $15, $16 now. He says, I can still get a 25% return. He buys it over here at $16. This is statistically correct. Okay? The stock rises, and he's in seventh heaven. The stock's going up. And he says it's going up a lot more. Doesn't check the data, doesn't check his homework, doesn't check the charts, doesn't check the fundamentals of the company, nothing. And it starts to waffle and comes down back to where he bought it again. He's not sure whether to sell it, take it or not. He's not sure whether to sell or buy it. Okay? Not sure whether to sell or buy it here. Buy more or sell it, get out of the position. It starts to come down. And typically speaking, the retail investor finally ended up with a loss and sell it around here, probably below where he bought it at. How many people have you spoken to who says, yeah, I just took a loss and as I bought it, it was going up, and all of a sudden it went down. This is a very, very common scenario. Charts don't always look like this. It's too easy to read. But the institutional and the professional investor puts the odds in their favor. They know the retail guys are out there dumping the stock. So they look for stability on average. They see the stock down here at 10. They've done their homework. They think the stock is worth $15 to $20 a share. When do you buy it? Maybe it'll go to 8 or 6 or 4. So they wait for this thing to rise in general. They'll give up 10, 15%. They don't care. And they see a stable level here of a lot of people buying the stock, institutions include, a lot of volume, which is hard to break through on the downside once you get that. It can happen, especially if negative news comes out. But by and large, from a charting standpoint, they'll buy 10, 15% of the base. When they get to this level, $15, $16 a share, they think it's worth 20, but you know what? They'll say, you know, we'll turn that stock over to the fools who want to buy it at $15, $16 a share, looking for 20%. Let them play the game on the risk side on the other side. And they'll take their 35, 40% on the stock and get out. And then wait for the fools to sell again at the low side and then come back in. It's a generic explanation of what charting is, but if somebody gives you a recommendation and you understand what to do here, it's a good corroboration of what that recommendation is all about. It gives you a buying or a selling inflection point, the buyer selling. Sam wants to take away the charting, avoid the insanity, put the odds in your favor. This is one way of protecting, again. You have to take a look at this. It requires some homework on your part. It requires a learning curve.
Excuse me, is his name Weinstein or Weissman?
Weinstein. W-E-I-N-S-T-E-I-N, Stanley. Okay. He has, you know, I don't think he publishes a tape reader anymore, but please remember, he's purely technical. He's not fundamental. He's not going to talk about a company and its management and how good the product is and what the competitors are. This man works off technicalities only, which is a tool someone like Bernie or Esther has used, or me, to buy and sell stocks, even if it's recommended by the brokerage firm they work for. They still want to check and see if it's really worthwhile. At least they should be. Okay? And is this the right time to do it? And they're going to take into account a lot of factors in the markets and the condition of that industry and the competitors and everything else, which you're hoping your research analyst is doing for you. Okay? And you will be more right than wrong if you pay attention to the data. Meaning, do your homework. Okay, that's the important part. Bonds, okay? A little bit easier scenario. If you understand that a bond is a loan, there are different maturity dates in bonds. A company wants to raise money. Equity means they sell a piece of their company to the public. Bonds means they're borrowing money to raise the capital. They want to build a building for $100 million. They go to Merrill Lynch, Merrill Lynch calls off their investors and their bond sellers, and they said, we got IBM, it's a double A rated, blah, 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 great company, this, do that. They're raising, they're going to give you 3.5% if you give them a 5, if you buy a 5-year bond. Meaning, like your mortgage. If you give them $5,000, $10,000, $100,000, $1 million, okay, they're going to give you 3% for your money until you have to pay you back. Like, just like a mortgage against the bank. When you have a bond portfolio, which is more likely for retirees, you're dealing with what I say is a big mover of prices.
Interest rates,
right? If interest rates are now fairly low, they're still pretty low, what's the expectation for interest rates? What would you expect?
Up.
You expect interest rates to go up, right? So what happens to the prices?
Up.
rule, but very few. But the longer maturity you go out, the more time you give to lend that company money, you buy a 30-year bond, a 20-year bond, okay? The more risk you're taking that they're gonna be around 10 years in the same status, 20 years from now. They have to pay you more interest. All right? The movement in the price of that bond, take this as a fact, I'm not gonna explain the numbers. The movement in the price of a bond, a 20-year bond, is going to be more radical with an interest rate change than a short-term bond. And they're going to pay you 5% return, okay, forever. They build in a feature into this indenture. This is very important. They build in a feature called a call feature. You know what that is?
They can get it back.
They can take it back from that point on. It doesn't mean they will. So if it's a 20-year bond and 7 years is an indenture, so we have the right to pay you par or even a little bit above par to take that bond away from you and you no longer have that bond. If your price is different, when you buy it, if you didn't buy it at par when the first was issued, you buy it at 102, 105, 95, okay? The yield to the call date is probably going to be the worst yield you're going to get between the two, the yield to maturity and the yield to call. The yield to call is very important to ask for when somebody recommends a bond to you. What is the yield to the call as well as the yield to maturity? In some cases, the yield to maturity will be 5%, but the yield to the call may be 2.1%. That's not what you're looking for, maybe. Okay? And again, there's no guarantee that any company is going to take that bond off the books and take it away from you and give you par. It depends on financial circumstances to them. You have a mortgage. You're paying 10% for your mortgage. Okay? Interest rates drop, and you say, God, I can get 5%. I can pay 5% instead of 10%. What do? You refinance, right? You get a 5%, that's what a company will do. They're paying out 5% to you for 20 years, and so the interest rates drop dramatically, and the call date comes up. Now they say, you know what, we can call this in, refinance that $100 million at 1.5-2% instead of 5%. That's what the call feature for them is for. So you always have to ask for the yield to the call, it's very important. Other protection features. Okay, trusts. Type of credit attorney. Brits, grants, gluts, rabbi trusts, you name it, credits and so forth. They are geared basically for the next generation. They're geared to conserve and think it. They're geared to conserve assets, conserve taxes for the next generation. Passing, again, this is another topic for discussion. Passing assets on to the next generation has a great deal to do with taxes as well. Transferring assets into a spouse's name may have a very beneficial effect on you. Umbrella policies on property and casualty. Everybody know what those are? It increases your protection factor, and they're not very expensive. State laws regarding homestead, Florida, okay? Annuities, long-term pensions. They all have various effects on the tax strategy. Living wills, everybody understand what those are? If you don't, write it down, ask your attorney what a living will or a trust is, okay? Very important to you. I'm running out of time here. All right, let me give you, I gave you this insanity thing. I'm gonna go over two situations with you that you could possibly do with grandchildren, or anybody you wanna recommend it to, somebody who's younger. I'm gonna make up a product. And I make it up right in front of you, okay? Fictitious. You give me $25,000 a year for 10 years, and don't give me another dime after that. You haven't put in $250,000 after 10 years, right? I'll say that it's going to be worth $260,000 after 10 years, for whatever reason. Not a great rate of return. Terrible return. But you don't have to give me another dime. What I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you that that bank account that is now $260,000 increased every single year at 7%. Not only that, I'll tell you that the instrument is tax-free 7%. Well, you're going to get 7% anywhere, let alone tax-free. No stocks involved, no bonds. Right? I'm giving you a risk-free product. Take care, guys. Addition to that product, every year that cash builds up, you have total access to it. You can take money out whenever you want. Not only that, but you can take it out tax-free.
even though it's built up. Not only that, but at age 60, let's say your son or daughter is 35 years of age, okay? At age 60, I'm going to tell you that you'll be able to take out, tax-free for the rest of your life, $60,000 a year. $70,000, $55,000, $58,000, whatever it is. In that range, $55,000 to $70,000 a year for the rest of your life. Is that a good pension? No risk, no stocks, no bonds? All you did was give me $250,000 for 10 years. Never put another dime in. Not only that, but as you're taking out the $60,000 a year tax-free, that account's still going to be growing. There could be millions of dollars in there. The longer you wait to take out that benefit, the more that grows. Too good to be true, right? It doesn't exist. I just made it up, right? Okay. Now I tell you that the product is 150 years old. What is it? No, it's not an annuity.
Social Security.
But a good guess.
Sure. Social Security.
Social Security, what?
Social Security.
What'd you say? It's insurance. Yeah, it's a life insurance policy. It's a whole life, 10-pay whole life insurance policy. I don't like life insurance, okay? This is a perfect addendum to IRAs, pension plans, 401ks, just another way. By the way, if that 35-year-old with decent health, with those numbers I just gave you, $2 million in life insurance.
I don't understand. What I live in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. I had a $10,000 life insurance.
Right.
And I figured I didn't need it anymore. My accountant told me, no problem. Mm-hmm. I sold it. I pay taxes.
You pay taxes on it, but that's not the benefit I'm talking about. You cancel the policy. There's a way to structure this, which is built into the policy, where you take an income out tax-free. Now, it depends on the policy you had. You got to understand there is a huge generation of product out there. All different types of policies. The older policies have different benefits and so on and so forth. There was a guarantee. If it's a whole life policy, you had a guaranteed minimum. What I'm talking about is a tax-free benefit without dissolving the policy up. You can dissolve the policy and take money out and pay taxes, but you still wouldn't pay full tax on it. Part of it is what you put into it in the first place. Your premiums are deducted from that. It's an exclusion, form of exclusion. By the way, with annuities, when you take out an annuity and then you annuitize it, you start taking out the income, do you pay full tax on that? No. There's something called an exclusion ratio. If you have annuities, write it down. It's important. Because when you take it out, the older you are, the larger the exclusion ratio. So the person 75 years old, let's say, I'm guessing, will have an exclusion ratio of 70-72%. Which means that whatever he takes out, he only pay taxes on 28-30% of it. Life insurance policies, you have to look into the policy itself, but by and large, cash value policies have the ability to just say, I want to collect it out tax free. If you take a loan, remember I said to you, it keeps increasing the value of that cash. If you take a loan from that policy and never pay it back, because you don't have to, it's just deducted from the beneficiary's amount. You have a $2 million policy, you take out $100,000, the beneficiary's going to get $1.9 million. In theory, if you take a loan against this, and let's say the pot is $500,000 in there, and you take a $50,000 loan out, okay, you're supposed to pay interest on that loan. In essence, you're paying it back into your own policy and cash value, not going to the insurance company. Technical jargon I don't want to get into. So that's one thing you can talk about with your children, considering the fact that if they're young and have kids or expect to have kids, that they're going to need the insurance anyway. Yes, this is a more expensive way of doing it. $10,000 a year, $5,000 a year, $25,000 a year, $500,000. It doesn't make a difference. It all makes sense. I'm not an insurance product salesman here. I'm telling you what you can do. It's not optimum, but it's a diversification. And it also solves the problem of insurance coverage. Which means you're going to get back a hell of a lot more than you would normally. If you pay a premium, let's say you buy an insurance policy and you're paying for till age 100. You pay premiums forever, or till age 65. The benefit in terms of the cash buildup is much larger when you put in short-term payments. Why? Because the insurance company's got more money to play with up front. And they're hoping to make money on that before they have to pay you out. Insurance companies don't lose money. Okay, last piece of information. I'm going to turn this around. and then we're finished. You can ask me any questions you want, I'll stay as long as you want. Just want to cover this out a little bit. Times. And annuities have a lot of negative connotation associated with them. For a lot of different reasons. Some of it's very real, some of it's not. A lot of people 10, 15, 20 years ago presented bonus opportunities, bogus opportunities to buy annuities. They sold them to world companies as an example I gave you beforehand. There's a new product now, it's called the hybrid annuity. I love this thing. I just found out about it a week or two ago. Honest to goodness. Okay? You put X amount of dollars in as a current 7% floor as an income. And what this is trying to do is it's trying to give you a lifetime income, like an annuity. It's trying to give you the benefit of market increases without taking a downside risk on the markets. Okay? It's trying to give you an income floor, typically 4%. Can be higher depending on the company. And the biggest argument against annuities, let me explain that. When you have an annuity, there are bells and whistles attached to it that you can choose whether it's death benefits or anything else, okay? Once you do that, okay, you're going to start paying for those options. You don't get anything for free. Guaranteed minimum returns, death benefits, and so on and so forth. So the typical annuity will have fees of anywhere from 2.25%, 2.5% to as much as 3%. So if you're going to get 6% return, you're paying every year 3%. Fees, your net is 3%, if inflation is 3%, this is what the standard argument against is. So what this hybrid annuity does, it gives you the benefit of that and charges 1% or less. Does anybody know what fees you pay in a mutual fund when you buy it? I'm finished with this.
Depends which company.
Huh?
Depends which company.
Mutual funds, if you read the fine print, most people never read the brochures. Okay. They have a fee attached to it. It's a monthly fee. It's deducted from the actual price of the stock, minimizing the out in the future of the mutual fund as it trades in the marketplace. You just don't see it. Okay? Anyway, this is a low fee. Take a look at these numbers and I'm finished. First year. No problem. The first year, put $400,000 in 7% current income floor, paying 1% fees. These are all calculated. First year, 7% of $400,000 gives you another $28,000, so it's more than $28,000. Okay? You can annuitize this anywhere after the first 13 months. Okay? Second year, 7% less than 1% fee, $457,960, $490,000, and so forth for 7 years. If at the end of 5 years, it's $561,000, I put in $400,000. Okay? I can now take out an annuity figure, guaranteed for the rest of my life, $31,477. Rest of my life guaranteed, no matter how long I live. If I wait 7 years, it's $640,000 in the pot, I can take out $33,000. This is my worst case scenario. My worst case scenario. Most of the time, in annuities, you lose control of the asset once you annuitize it. When you turn that spigot on, you're no longer in control. This product allows you to take monies out anytime you want. You have control. Of course, the benefit payout is going to be less if you take money out. Very
what would you be making on $400,000 over that 5 years before you can start taking down? No, and not this, in something else, just investing in...
Pick it, I don't know. Pick any number you want.
10%, 12%.
Can you make 10% a year? Great way to check, will you?
8%.
You can get anything you want, and you can compare it to anything you want, which is why I talk about diversification. You don't want to put all your eggs in one basket. You don't want to do that. You're 100% correct. With any other investment, unless you've got a bond, let's say it's got a fixed coupon on it, okay? You don't really have a guarantee of the return. You really don't.
Well, the market does 10.4%.
That's the market. Now, you know the market can drop 30% the next year.
In any given time, but on the long run.
Perfect leading. Now look at this column, okay? What this product, hybrid annuity, says you're going to invest in. There's a second bucket. Can you see that? Second pool. Okay? Market went up 11%. Okay? Thank you. Okay? Market went up 11%. You're going to lose it 1% for the fee annually. The value of that account is $440,000 instead of $428,000. Okay? Second year, market dropped. Okay? The value of this account went from $440,000 to $436,000. Fictitious numbers. Okay? And so on and so forth. If I decide to annuitize at the end of 2 years in this product, a lot of companies offer this now, okay? Which one will they pay me off of? The 436 or the 457, whichever is higher. So at the end of 7 years, as an example, my 400,000 went to 800,000. What's the return? 7 years. Rule of 72.
Doubles in 7.
Which is approximately what? 7 years times 12, about 12% a year? Okay? The number you're talking about, right? $800,000 value. At the end of 7 years here, my minimum worst case scenario is I'm going to collect 33,000 plus. But this pot is bigger based on the investment structure. I'm going to get paid off of that at 44,000 a year for the rest of my life.
And this is tax free, you say, or no?
No, not tax free. It's an annuity, you pay taxes at the end. By the way, annuities, by the way, I like ERISA instruments, pension instruments, okay? 59.5. So what, if you take money out before 59.5, you have to pay possibly a tax penalty of 10%. The point is that over this entire period of this hybrid annuity, you have access to all the cash, and annuity you don't. Most annuities will allow you a 10% withdrawal per year, that kind of stuff, without any penalties. Okay? They have fixed maturities, so to speak. 5 years, 4 years, 5 years, 7 years, 10 years, you can make a choice. I'm finished.
Do you have the names of any of the companies that are selling these type of things?
I can get you, give me a call. Do you have my phone number?
No.
Okay, I'll give you my card.
I'll call you right now.
I don't have the list. A lot of companies picked up on this. It's very interesting.